Thank you. The next item of business is a statement by Lorna Slater on deposit return scheme. The Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interruptions or interventions. And I call on Minister Lorna Slater. Around 10 minutes, please.
I welcome this opportunity to update Parliament on the deposit return scheme, following the First Minister's statement earlier this week. Scotland's deposit return scheme is an ambitious and transformational upgrade to Scotland's recycling infrastructure. It has already seen hundreds of millions of pounds invested across the country and is creating hundreds of new green jobs in the recycling industry, with many more to come. It will reduce litter by a third, increase recycling rates of single-use drinks containers to 90%, and cut CO2 emissions by 4 million tonnes over 25 years. This is the kind of change we need to see if we are to remain true to our commitment to tackle the climate emergency and to leverage private investment behind a green and circular economy. However, Presiding Officer, as both the First Minister and I have said this week, we cannot deliver on this ambition without an exclusion from the UK Government on the Internal Market Act. With just 4 months to go, that exclusion has not been issued, making a delay to the scheme unavoidable. We also have heard the concerns expressed by businesses, particularly small businesses, and want to do more to support them. With this in mind, I will today set out a new timetable for Scotland's DRS, provide an overview of a new package of measures to simplify the scheme and to support businesses to participate. And I will finish with next steps on our engagement with the UK Government. Presiding Officer, there has been significant progress by businesses, large and small, in preparing for the scheme. Around £300 million of investment has been committed in systems, infrastructure and staff time, with many businesses fully prepared to launch the scheme. The scheme administrator, Circularity Scotland, has developed the logistical network that will support the operation of the scheme, and ground has been broken on sites across Scotland, including sorting centres in Aberdeen and Motherwell, that are creating up to 200 new green jobs. I am very grateful to all those who have helped make this happen. However, in recent months, progress has stalled. Presiding Officer, the primary cause of this has been the uncertainty created by the continued failure by the UK Government to issue an IMA exclusion.
Members, I said there should be no interventions or interruptions. Minister, please continue.
Together with public briefings against the scheme from the Secretary of State for Scotland, the effect has been corrosive, undermining confidence, stalling progress and halting private investment. Some businesses have said they will simply not join the scheme because of the UK Government's position. And there has been extensive feedback from industry that they are not willing to proceed with investments until they have clarity. This is an ambitious, major infrastructure scheme that affects thousands of businesses and everyone in Scotland. Readiness for August was always going to be challenging, particularly given the difficult conditions that industry has faced in recent years. But the chilling effect as a result of Westminster's position has made it impossible. Scotland's deposit return scheme will now go live on the 1st of March 2024. This gives the time needed for the UK Government to fulfil its duties, and for businesses, it gives a full 10 months from now to get ready for launch. Earlier this week, I met with representatives of producers and retailers to outline this new timetable with them. I want to acknowledge their constructive response and the suggestions they have made to ensure these 10 months are used to full effect. And I look forward to continuing to engage with them to ensure we make the progress that we need to together. I have also asked the partners of this scheme, CSL, SEPA and Zero Waste Scotland, to work with my officials and with businesses to deal promptly with any remaining issues to allow businesses to prepare. Presiding Officer, while Scotland's DRS is an industry-led scheme, just as similar schemes are across the world, the Scottish Government has consistently worked in partnership with businesses to facilitate progress and to ensure a pragmatic approach is taken to implementing the scheme. That's why we are removing the obligation on the vast majority of online retailers to provide take-back services. It's why earlier this year, CSL brought forward a £22 million package of support to improve cash flow for producers. And that's why we have listened carefully to the suggestions of small businesses, in particular, that have made in the last few weeks, with a view to developing a package of measures that are fair, pragmatic, and support the overall aims of the scheme. The key elements of that package are as follows. Firstly, all drinks containers under 100 millilitres will be completely excluded from the scheme. This will benefit businesses in the soft drinks, wine, and particularly the spirits industry, who have raised particular concerns about miniatures, while removing just 0.2% of articles from the scheme. Secondly, products with low sales volumes will be excluded from the scheme. This change applies to any product which sells less than 5,000 items a year. This will apply to all businesses, so a large business which has a niche product line with low sales volumes will not need to apply a deposit to that line, and a small business which only sells low volume products will not need to apply a deposit to any of their products. This change will only remove about 0.5% of articles from the scheme, but will remove the need for around 44% of businesses to apply a deposit to their products, effectively removing many of the smallest producers from the scheme. Thirdly, we plan to exempt all hospitality premises who sell the large majority of their drinks products for consumption on the premises from acting as a return point. Regulations already exempt premises that exclusively sell drinks on site, such as restaurants, pubs, and nightclubs. However, many hospitality businesses also sell a small proportion of drinks to take away. Where this is the case, we agree they need not operate as a return point, given that they will already be operating a closed-loop system for drinks on sale. We will engage with hospitality businesses on the proportion of sales at which this will apply to ensure a balance between support for businesses and accessibility for customers. Also in partnership with Zero Waste Scotland, we have simplified the online process for retailers to apply for an exemption from operating a return point following feedback from businesses that have used the online application system. Finally, I am aware of the concern that some businesses have around the size and complexity of the producer agreement with Circularity Scotland. To help with this, I have asked Circularity Scotland to develop a short-form producer agreement, which will help reduce the burden on these businesses. Throughout the process of developing DRS, we have worked closely with officials in the UK government. However, the UK government still have to issue an Internal Market Act exclusion, even though we first raised the need for one in 2021. We have followed the agreed process and provided all material that has been asked of us, and I had expected to finally get a decision at the most recent interministerial group meeting on Monday of this week. However, no decision was forthcoming, and ministers were unable to provide a time frame for one. Let me be clear. Scotland's DRS is within the devolved competence.
Minister, sorry, could you resume your seat just for a second, please? I have said at the outset that there should be no interventions or interruptions whilst the Minister is speaking. There will be opportunities after the Minister has concluded her statement to ask questions. Minister, please resume.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me be clear. Scotland's DRS is within the devolved competence of the Scottish Government and Parliament. It is not for Westminster to undermine our democracy in this way. Following this statement, we will write to the UK Government to inform them of the new timetable and support package and to request once again for an urgent decision to allow the scheme to proceed as I have outlined. I am confident this will happen because there is no reasonable justification for this request to be refused. It's the right outcome for businesses, for Scotland, and for the UK, who will benefit from our scheme leading the way, and we remain committed to continue to share lessons with the UK government. Alongside this IMA exclusion, we are also working with the UK government on issues related to trading standards, which are important for producers and retailers. Businesses need answers on these issues in short order. And again, I ask that the UK government work with us, businesses and regulators, to resolve these critical issues in a timely manner. Presiding Officer, let me finish by saying that I and this government are committed to Scotland's deposit return scheme. This commitment is unwavering because I believe in climate action. I believe in investing in green infrastructure, in creating the green jobs of the future. So I call on members across this chamber who share these values to put an end to their increasingly desperate attempts to undermine Scotland's deposit return scheme. Because right now, it looks like colleagues on the Labour and Tory benches have given up on recycling, on tackling the litter crisis, on the climate emergency, and even on the authority of this Parliament to make decisions in devolved areas. That's what this comes down to. Scotland's Parliament legislated to make deposit return happen, and I, as a Minister of the Scottish Government, am delivering on that democratic mandate. But a Tory Westminster government that Scotland didn't vote for appears to be using the post-Brexit powers that they gave themselves to stop this vital scheme in its tracks. Labour and the Tories might have given up on devolution.
Minister, sorry to interrupt again. Please resume your seat just a wee second. I have said this is the third and last time I'll say this. The Minister is making a statement, as is the common practice when ministers make statements. There are to be no interventions or interruptions. Thank you. Minister, please conclude.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Labour and the Tories might have given up on devolution. We have not. I and this Scottish Government will work tirelessly to deliver on our mandate and to protect this Parliament's right to work for the people of Scotland.
Thank you, Minister. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. And I would ask those members who would wish to ask a question if they would please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I thank the Minister for advance sight of the statement. The only party in this chamber that's given up on recycling is the SNP. Mm-hmm. And indeed their partners in the Greens, having not met the 2013 household recycling target which the Scottish Government set. But this statement confirms the SNP Green approach. Constitutional grievance first and business second. The Scottish Government have been sitting on this scheme since 2009. Before they finally got round to introducing regulations and setting a launch date of April 21. Then we had a delay, then another delay, then this week, with the Minister having lost control of the scheme, the First Minister had to step in and announce yet another delay. The Minister won't be happy with that, having said, and I quote, "No one with any credibility would delay the scheme again." And that it would be a quote, kick in the teeth to industry. But the Minister has made such an almighty mess of this scheme that she has now had to effectively rewrite it. Today's changes should have been made months ago. Businesses can't have confidence in the scheme that sees continual delays and massive changes at the last minute. Let's be clear. This isn't an industry-led scheme. The Scottish waste sector has been excluded. Small businesses have been excluded from membership of the scheme administrator. And in any case, Donald McCalman from Circularity Scotland said today, and I quote, "We are not running the scheme." I think that's an important misconception to address. So, can the Minister provide a helpful answer? And I'm not interested in pre-scripted flim-flam telling me information that I already know. Will registered producers be held liable for advance months' payments during this delay? Yes or no?
Minister. I'm sorry, due to the noise around me, I couldn't hear the question. Could you just repeat the last bit, please?
Yes, could I, sorry, Mr. Coleman, before you you stand up to ask again your question. The question would have been heard if members in the front bench and other parts of the benches I'm looking at directly had not heckled you whilst you answer your question. Asking you questions, that perhaps is a salutary lesson for everybody this afternoon, if you could just let the person who has the floor be the speaker at that particular moment in time. Douglas Lumsden. Maurice Golden. Oh, you can get confused.
I'm much younger than Douglas Lumsden. So my question, will the well-registered producers be held liable for advance months' payments during this delay, yes or no?
Minister.
The member asks a very interesting question there at the end, which is around the agreement between the producers and Circularity Scotland, which is a contract that they have signed. And the member may be reassured that only the very largest producers are liable for the costs under that contract.
And I call Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I also thank the Minister for advance notice of her statement? Though I have to say I'm deeply disappointed by the tone and content of the statement. And can I put on record that the response by the First Minister to my letter yesterday was merely a political attack, which unfortunately the Minister is repeating today? Because businesses, the hospitality sector and recycling companies have been stressed and have highlighted their concerns for months, and being told to go to a website by the Minister for the last few months has not cut it, especially when the information they sought wasn't even there. And now that we have this inevitable delay, surely we need a grown-up approach from both the UK and the Scottish governments to ensure we get a scheme that will not disadvantage Scottish businesses and consumers. Scottish Labour is absolutely clear we support the principle of a DRS scheme. They have been successful in other countries. And in the debate today, we will highlight our commitment to stronger action on climate emergency. But even now, there is no admission in this statement about what's been wrong with this scheme as its design. And that's why we've been asking questions for months. A key issue I want some response from the Minister on is the implementation of the scheme. She said again it's been given to the private company Circularity Scotland. Doesn't represent small businesses with no accountability or parliamentary oversight. They've already given the contract to BIFA, now a US hedge fund owned company, which will put jobs, local recycling companies at risk and give them a monopoly over what prices are charged in the future. So will the Minister now roll back on this? What will remain a concern to businesses is the exact detail of how the scheme is to be implemented. So will the Minister now commit to meet with those producers, members of the hospitality sector and recycling companies who will still face major challenges even with the changes she has announced today?
Minister.
I thank the member very much. I continue to meet with producers, members of the retail sector, hospitality sector, and I'm happy to meet with recyclers in the sector as well. Engagement with industry and with business has been a core part of how we've been delivering this. Indeed, after the First Minister's statement on Tuesday, I held rapid meetings with producers, retailers, and with the NGOs in the sector as well that very afternoon, which is just a continuing example of the kind of engagement we've had along. I'll go through some of the timeline here because I think that might be useful for the member to understand. Since last year, we've developed considerable momentum toward what was intended to be the launch this year in August. And that included working with industry on their concerns toward the scheme. The way that the regulations were passed by this Parliament were deliberately broad to allow industry to make those adjustments and decisions that were right for industry. This scheme is paid for by industry and delivered by industry. I suppose this Parliament could have passed a scheme that was paid for by the taxpayer and controlled by government, but that is not what this Parliament passed. But within the scope of delivering this scheme, there are some key partners. One is the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament. We passed the regulations. SEPA enforces those regulations, and industry's job is to adhere to the regulations. Circularity Scotland is a private, not-for-profit business that has been created by industry to enable them to comply with the regulations as passed by this Parliament. Throughout the process of delivering this project, industry has come back to me as a representation of the Scottish Government and said, look, there are certain elements of this scheme we would like to clarify, to get detail on, to improve. And so we have done so. We clarified the process for streamlining exclusions. We got rid of online take-back for most people who would have been responsible for it. We got
members, please, some courtesy. Minister.
We worked with Circularity Scotland, who in March delivered £22 million worth of cash flow. And today I have also announced significant adjustments to the delivery of the scheme that have been asked for by industry. Industry asked us to exclude miniatures. We have done so. Industry asked us to look at what could be done for small producers. 44% of small producers are now not required to have a deposit on this scheme. So the member should be clear that I have systematically worked through and delivered on what industry are asking for. And now we have 10 months from now to the new launch date. And I am looking forward to working with industry to get to that launch date successfully. On Tuesday, the businesses I engaged with had some very constructive, and I thank them for this, suggestions as to how we might work together to do that, and I will continue to do that.
Thank you. I would point out that we would probably need succinct questions and, indeed, Minister, succinct answers in order to allow me to take as many members as I possibly can in the time that we have available. I call Fiona Hislop to be followed by Liam Kerr. Ms Hislop.
President Officer, I am having difficulty hearing the Minister, and I think time would be best spent with questions and answers. It's been taken up by a lot of noise from the Conservatives. Can the Minister... This takes up time.
Everything takes up time, Ms Hislop, and I'll try to deal with that as best I can. Please continue.
Thank you, President Officer. Can the Minister now suggest that CEPA and Circularity Scotland provide clarity on the basis for the scheme for small hospitality businesses like the Dreadnought in Bathgate I recently visited, who already recycle 100% of their glass bottles, cans and other waste using existing CEPA systems of recording such recycling? And what consideration has been given to these hospitality closed-loop venues like theirs, who will have difficulty storing waste destined for recycling securely, where the same company designated by Circularity Scotland to collect in the future currently will only do so from the public main street, which brings serious security issues for what will be a valuable commodity?
Minister.
All scheme articles bear a deposit which hospitality businesses will have paid when they purchase those materials. And hospitality businesses can only redeem that deposit by ensuring that scheme articles are returned. So removing them from the scheme is not possible. The scheme will allow closed-loop hospitality businesses to have their material collected for free, saving them money while keeping up the high levels of recycling. I'm aware that CSL continue to work with the hospitality industry to ensure a smooth working of the scheme.
I call Liam Kerr to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister was asked whether there might be liabilities arising and confirmed that there will be. So can the Minister tell me what is the total liability expressed as a figure for registered producers and retailer contractual commitments for RVMs resulting from this delay?
Minister.
This is a matter of the contractual agreement between Circularity Scotland and the producers, and the member can be reassured that only the very largest producers, those making more than 10 million units per year, are required to underwrite the costs. It's an agreement between a private company and their customers. It is not a matter for the Scottish Government.
I call Claire Adamson to be followed by Mercedes Viala.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Prior to Brexit, which of course Scotland didn't want, we had regulatory divergence, and this Parliament could be secure in legislating in devolved areas. Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee has consistently raised concerns about the lack of transparency about the frameworks and the nature of the relationship between the governments and how those are developing. So the two-year delay of the UK Government in its decision on Internal Markets Act exclusions under the common frameworks can only leave the impression that the UK Government is trampling over the devolution settlement. Does the Minister agree?
Minister.
I share the member's deep frustration. Let me be clear, this should not be how devolution works. I am deeply concerned by the broader implications of the UK Government using their powers under the Internal Market Act in this way to undermine the common frameworks and devolve decisions taken by this Parliament. And I know the Welsh Government are, sorry, the Welsh Government are also concerned about this. The common frameworks were meant to provide a means to resolve issues such as these, and my ask to the UK government is clear. We need to follow the process, the agreed published process, engage constructively, and agree an exclusion quickly. This is the best outcome, not just for Scotland and Scottish businesses, but for the UK as a whole.
I call Mercedes Nialba to be followed by John Mason.
In February this year, the Circular Economy Minister claimed there were 500 new jobs out for recruitment as part of the deposit return scheme, including 60 in Aberdeen, all of which contribute to our just transition. And in March, the Minister announced that 664 businesses had registered with the scheme ahead of the August launch. So can the Minister share what assessments the Scottish Government has made into the impact of this significant delay on these new jobs and on the cost to those businesses and organisations who have already invested in changes to their operations as part of the scheme?
Minister.
The member is quite right. Many businesses in Scotland have invested heavily toward the August launch date, and that includes recruiting people, setting up IT systems, getting ready to install reverse vending machines. This delay, which is caused from the prevarication of the UK government to give us only weeks from the launch of the scheme, something we asked for 2 years ago, the prevarication of the UK government to issue this exemption, has absolutely been frustrating for those businesses. It's frustrating for me and for those businesses who have made that substantial investment. So I can absolutely understand that those businesses, as I said to the member quoted me accurately, I think that delay by the UK government is a kick in the teeth to those businesses who have worked so hard toward that. But the businesses may be reassured that that investment is not lost. That investment will be valuable toward working to our March 1st launch, because the Scottish Government is committed to deposit return and we will be working toward a successful launch in March next year.
I call John Mason to be followed by Brian Whittam.
Thank you. The Minister mentioned trading standards in her statement. I wonder if she could expand a little bit on that as to exactly what agreement she needs from trading standards. Does that include the question of how deposits will be displayed in the price? And is the UK Government being constructive in this regard?
Minister.
I thank the member very much for this question. This is actually a really important question that affects Scottish businesses and, in fact, businesses all across the UK as they implement their deposit return schemes. Trading standards have indicated that their interpretation of the price marking legislation is that the deposit must be included in the price displayed for a product. We believe their approach risks confusion for customers. We believe it is important that it is clear that the deposit on products is refundable, and therefore do not believe that it should be included in the price displayed, but instead highlighted separately, as the deposit return regulations require. This is the approach of DRS schemes in other countries. Trading standards is a reserved policy, so we cannot adjust the regulations ourselves. However, we have called on the UK government to amend the relevant legislation that does not currently explicitly cover deposit return schemes to make it clear that the deposit price can be displayed separately. Scottish Government officials are working closely with DEFRA, the Welsh Government and the Department of Business and Trade to seek a consistent approach to deposit pricing across the UK, particularly as we believe that the UK will want a similar approach as we are proposing when they launch their own scheme.
I call Brian Whittle to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Now, Circularity Scotland's role is to deliver the scheme as per government instruction. SEPA are the regulators of the scheme. But despite hundreds of questions that have been asked of the Minister, we are still unclear as to her role. Perhaps the Minister would take this opportunity to tell us what her responsibilities are, and will she finally commit to working with all MSPs across the Chamber who are incidentally supportive of a workable DRS scheme, ditch the positive squirming and listen to affected industries when they raise legitimate concerns?
Minister.
As I have gone through in detail when the member on my right asked a question, I have engaged with businesses effectively, that's producers, retailers, I have spoken with MSPs in this chamber, I have done extensive engagement, and that is how we have this series of impact, changes we've made to the DRS, changes to the operational scheme that we've done specifically to address what industry has asked for. So I have given extensive detail, and I'm sure the presiding officer doesn't want me to go through it again, of exactly all the ways that we've listened to businesses to get ready for this launch. Now, we have 10 months ahead of us to our March 1st date, and I am really looking forward to and had constructive engagement again with retailers and producers on Tuesday as to how we're going to work together to become a really effective delivery body to get this scheme launched successfully on March 1st, and I am looking forward to doing just that.
I call Christine Graham, followed by Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I note the Minister has met recently with representatives of producers and retailers, which is good. But has she met with RMAS, Resource Management Association Scotland, which I have? It represents 400 companies, small medium enterprise, operating in waste management with 6,690 employees. Because they have concerns with BIFA having the monopoly, these businesses will be put out of work and those jobs are at risk.
Minister.
I thank the member. I have met with RMAS some time ago, not specifically on this matter, though. I share the member's concern about the impact on existing recyclers and waste companies. My officials have been in discussion with CSL about this matter, and we are clear that we must harness the opportunities for existing recyclers within the DRS scheme. As such, CSL have indicated that as part of BIFA's responsibility for building and operating an efficient and effective collections network, they are in active discussions with several existing waste collection companies to explore how those organisations can work with BIFA for DRS. They remain keen to engage with other such companies and have a dedicated forum on their website to allow firms to make contact and open up discussions. And I urge recycling and waste companies to do just that and get in contact with BIFA.
I call Liam MacArthur to be followed by Mark Roscoe.
Thank you. This is a remarkable statement as an exercise in blame shifting that is both ill-advised and I think lacking in self-awareness. Over the last 2 years, I've spoken to many businesses, not one of which has mentioned the UK government, all of whom have criticised the Scottish Government's approach. The Minister says that she set out further changes today. She's insisted that this is a genuinely industry-led scheme, and therefore can she confirm that she will be open to considering any other changes that particularly small businesses believe are still required?
Minister.
I thank the member for his statement. I mean, I have been engaging with businesses, large and small, with trade associations, and the number one thing that businesses have raised with me as their concern is uncertainty around the scheme, and particularly the uncertainty created by the lack of the UK government issuing this exclusion on the internal market. Because specifically, businesses are saying to me, why should I invest in this
members.
Scheme, which the UK government, Alistair Jack, is saying he might veto? Why should they put millions of pounds of their money on the line when the UK government is creating this level of uncertainty?
Absolutely.
So the businesses that I have spoken to have either held or paused their investment or told me they are not willing to participate in the scheme until the UK government gives them that clarity. So that clarity we need first off from the UK government. But as I've outlined today, I have been listening clearly to businesses at all stages. And the simplification measures announced today are significant, particularly for small producers. That limit of 5,000 units, which applies to producers of all size, but in particular is a benefit for small producers who do not wish to have a deposit on their items. They could have a deposit on their items if they want to. They can still opt in that way. But that means that 44% of those smallest producers will not have a deposit on their articles, which is a significant support and exactly the kind of measure that small businesses have been asking for.
I call Mark Ruskell to be followed by Fergus Ewing.
Across the country, I can see DRS facilities appearing in supermarkets, sorting centres being built and hundreds of jobs being created. With over 95% of the market for cans and bottles already signed up, businesses and the Minister should actually be getting congratulated for getting the UK's first DRS scheme this close to being launched. But given that huge private sector investment that has already been delivered in our communities, can I ask the Minister what the reaction from those businesses has been to the continued failure of the UK government to grant an exemption under the Internal Markets Act?
Minister.
For all the moaning and groaning and theatrics to my left here, it is a fact that we need an exclusion issued on the Internal Market Act for this scheme to be launched. That is a fact. That is an absolute fact. And I absolutely share the members' deep frustration. Let me be clear, this should not be how devolution works. Businesses work best when they have certainty, and that is what they have asked us and the UK government for. The continuing uncertainty on the UK government position is undermining progress. We are hearing businesses are pausing further preparation and investment until a UK government decision is agreed. I continue to urge the UK government to agree the exclusion as soon as possible to provide certainty for businesses. But on a happier note, I also am excited to start seeing reverse vending machines in shops and to see it's actually happening. People are tweeting when they're seeing them in shops and stuff, and it is really exciting to seeing that start to happen.
I call Fergus Ewing to be followed by Colin Smith.
Officer, the Minister has mentioned devolution. Surely the aim of devolution is to do things better, not just to do things differently for the sake of it. And does she not agree, and will she agree too, the main two business asks that are outstanding? One is to remove glass from scope, as it is in the UK, and two, given the further delay, which I predict will be extended, that there should be alignment with the UK, thereby removing double costing, double labelling, 700 lost jobs that will happen in the waste management sector, and all the detritus of the dire complexity of a broken, defective scheme.
Minister.
Presiding officer, I often do forget that Fergus Ewing is actually not a member of the Conservative Party, given the support he's getting there. That was quite an impressive round of applause for him. Greenpeace says, and I quote, "In what kind of world is collecting glass drinks containers not an essential part of a system designed to collect drinks containers?" Honestly, of the 44 schemes around the world that already exist, 40 of them collect glass. It is normal for the glass to be part of this scheme. And indeed, Morris Golden wrote an extensive blog post on it, which he has since deleted, but I can quote you from if anyone interested in hearing what Morris Golden used to say about the benefits of glass before he rethought his position. I am, of course, very disappointed that the UK government has chosen to exclude glass for the scheme.
This Minister, please resume your seat. A second point of order.
Certainly.
Morris Golden.
Point of order. I have not deleted any article ever, and I think it's absolutely outrageous to be accused of that from a minister in this place. I have not changed my position on DRS, and there is no way that I should be slandered in this place by a minister of the Scottish Government.
Minister, could I respond to the point of order, please? I thank Morris Golden for his contribution. That, of course, is not a point of order. It does not engage myself as the presiding officer and the chair. The member has made his point and it's on the record. Minister, please resume.
Thank you. Well, I'll be delighted. Anyone then can presumably go onto the web and find this quote from Morris's blog post, which says that we have an opportunity to create an ambitious and inclusive UK-wide scheme, including glass, which will tackle litter and improve recycling rates. So, obviously, I'm disappointed that the UK has not chosen to go with the kind of global norm of including glass in the scheme. It will reduce the environmental effectiveness of the scheme. Glass is one of the most common items to pollute our beaches and public spaces. It is also one of the litter items that causes most concern, particularly among parents and pet owners, because of its potential to cause injury. So in Scotland, we will continue to include glass in our scheme because it is the right thing to do.
I call Colin Smith to be followed by Keith Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the gap between any Scottish scheme and one in the rest of the UK continues to narrow, will the Minister use the next 10 months to seek to ensure that any Scottish scheme aligns as close as possible to other schemes in the UK in areas such as labelling, product size, exemptions? Because my South Scotland constituents on the border who routinely purchase products either side of the border in their daily lives should be able to return those products to either side of the border wherever they purchase them.
Minister.
Absolutely. I can reassure the member that we are committed to the interoperability of the scheme, and today's announcement on the 100 millilitre containers is part of that alignment. Of course, I'm very much hoping that the UK will align with us and include glass in their scheme.
I call Keith Brown to be followed by Craig Coyne. Mr. Brown.
Can I thank the Minister for her statement, which I know will be welcomed by smaller producers like Williams Brothers, based in my constituency, who I met with earlier this week, particularly if the extended consultation works closely with SMEs. And whilst I agree and endorse what the Minister has said by the fact that the Tory party doesn't know whether it wants to support it, oppose it, or just play constitutional politics in order to disrupt the process, could the Minister also give reassurances that discussions will take place with supermarkets and other retailers to ensure that smaller producers who are excluded from the scheme are not adversely impacted by retailers only stocking registered scheme articles?
Minister.
I thank the member very much for the question. Of course, it is important to note that even those small producers whose items are excluded from the scheme do still need to register with SEPA and give them the information on their quantities so that they can be properly excluded and follow the rules properly. It is a commercial decision for individual businesses whether they wish to participate in this important environmental scheme by selling products on the Scottish market, but we would encourage any business to contact Circularity Scotland in the first instance for support and to discuss any concerns that they have about participating in the scheme.
And I call Craig Hoy.
Presiding Officer, can I apologise for arriving slightly late for the statement? Despite some concessions today, Lorna Slater is still just kicking the can down the road. So can she explain what compensation she is considering for small hospitality operators who may already have incurred considerable costs? And whilst climb downs are the order of the day, will she now do the right thing and exclude small pubs and restaurants altogether?
Minister.
So, as I've already outlined in terms of the exclusions for hospitality businesses, small pubs and nightclubs and so on who only operate as a closed loop were already excluded from acting as return points. That was already part. They have to be part of the scheme as a closed loop matter because when they buy these items, they will have a deposit. And by participating as a closed loop, they get that money back. They're going to need to get that money back. So they have to participate as a closed loop. But we are exempting them from acting as a return point. And today's announcement means that further hospitality businesses, those who for most of their products are consumed in-house, will not be obliged to act as a return point. So this simplifies things a great deal for hospitality businesses. For those closed-loop hospitality businesses, they will have those materials collected for free. That is a substantial cost saving to those businesses, and that is how we are supporting the hospitality industry.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the statement, which I allowed to run on, if I could just finish briefly, for a bit longer, because there was such interest on the part of members across the chamber wishing to ask questions. And I apologise to the few members I was not able to fit in, because we did allow the statement to run on quite considerably to accommodate as many members as possible. Point of order, Maurice Goldson.
Presiding Officer. The Minister referred to a blog post which I've made. I have never written a blog, and therefore I couldn't have published a blog and then subsequently deleted it. And I would appreciate if the Minister would correct the official record and apologise, because it's outrageous to suggest I have done something which I have not, and it might be considered an abuse of ministerial privilege to do so.
I thank Maurice Goldson for his further contribution. Obviously, correction of the record is a matter for the member concerned, and that is what I can say as the presiding officer. Further presiding officer, point of order from Mark Ruskell.
On a further point of order, presiding officer, I think it is important that members provide accurate information on the record. And I've just been sat here at my desk actually reading the said blog from Maurice Goldson from 2019, which I believe is in an archive. So it makes very interesting reading. And I think it's just important, presiding officer, that all members are accurate and truthful about their previous positions on matters of policy as well as their current positions.
I would advise Mr. Ruskell that that is not a point of order either. Thank you. And I believe it's now time to move on to the next item of business, but before which there will be a short pause to allow front bench. Please, Mr. Kerr, to allow front bench teams to change positions should they so wish. Thank you.